Good morning. It's a pleasure to welcome you this morning to our online service of worship. As you can see, I'm taking advantage of a bit of sunshine and making the most of the manse garden. But I hope and pray that as we meet together in this way, that you are all safe and well. Whether you are with family or on your own, whether you are near or maybe further away, you are more than welcome to our worship here this morning. And just before our service starts, I want to take a moment just to say thank you to all who have helped with this service, both in word and in music. As we come to worship and as we prepare to worship, our desire is simple. It is to be with God and for Him to be present with us. The psalmist writes these words: "Those who seek Him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever." Then let us come to worship God. Our call this morning, I'm using part of the psalm that Viv will read to us later on in the service. I'm going to use the first three verses of Psalm 139. Let's listen to God's word. "O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know me when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Hear us, loving God, as we confess our weaknesses and failing. Bring us into the light of your love as we seek you for mercy and forgiveness. May we know your mercy and grace in Jesus. Amen."
I hear the calling.
Let us unite our hearts in prayer. Let us pray. It is good to meet together for worship and prayer. It is good to take time together for fellowship in your name. It is good to know your presence and take that blessing everywhere. A prayer of adoration. From our rising to our lying down, you are with us every moment of the day. Our reassurance when storms assail, our strength when courage fails. From our rising to our lying down, your light brightens every step along the way. Our comfort when darkness falls, the peace that calms our soul. From our rising to our lying down, you are with us always. A prayer of confession. You see, even in our weakness and failings, God is present with us, not to criticize, not to condemn, but to love as we seek his mercy and forgiveness. So let's just take a moment and confess our sins. Gracious God, you have grown fertile seeds into our hearts, good gardener. And we, willingly or by neglect, allow weeds to grow and spoil the beauty of this small corner of your garden. Keep our hearts free of that which hides your love, we pray. And prune away all that hinders, that others might see only your beauty blossoming within. And a prayer of thanksgiving. Thank you, Lord, for your sustaining love with us each day as it unfolds, in our venturing out and in our returning, with the people we meet and in our conversation, in those moments of joy and in our frustration. Thank you for a love that sustains us, revives us and enables us to be the people you have called us to be, servants of your word and bearers of good news in this, your beautiful world. All-knowing God, we gather with praise and thanksgiving for who you are and for all that you have done for us. You know us better than we know ourselves, all our thoughts and actions, and yet you love us. No matter where we go or what we do, your love, it encircles us, ahead and behind of us, gently leading and guiding and blessing. We praise you for your love and your faithful presence in our lives. Lord, we pray that your Spirit would move in our hearts and minds as we worship together. Examine our attitudes and actions. Lay bare the things we need to confess. Challenge us with your word. And guide us onto the paths that lead to life. For we are your people, called by your name. Amen.
Our psalm today is Psalm 139, verses 1 to 12, and verses 23 to 24. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before. You lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
All-knowing and ever-present God, we praise you for how you know us and love us. We praise you that this truth declared to us in Scripture is not just a truth for us, but indeed for all you have created. You know each of us with intimacy. You saw us created in our mother's womb and know the very number of hairs on each of our heads. How wonderful are your works, O God. We know that full well. As we come to you in prayer, we give thanks that you are near to listen and mighty at work. We bring before you the concerns of our hearts for others. For those in need of your healing, we pray that you once again knit together their bodies, restoring brokenness and destroying disease. We pray for your wisdom and skill for medical practitioners, and we ask for your boundless peace to overflow in all. For those who are bearing the weight of grief, we ask for your comfort as you draw near, strengthening them and upholding them. You know the thoughts that circle in their minds. You know the heartache, you know the tears. Encircle them in your wonderful love in such abundance that they cannot escape the sense of your presence. For those for whom the world seems to have been darkened, whether it be from anxiety or fear, from external stresses or internal battles, we pray, Lord, for your light to shine. Your word declares that even darkness is not dark to you. And so, wonderful Lord, expel the darkness that encircles our lives. Make the doubt flee and the worry fly away. Strengthen and empower us with your presence and power, that the light of your love would overflow and defeat the darkness of this time. For those who feel alone, who have lost sight of their value and worth, or been belittled or abandoned, we pray power to these words of Scripture that declare that we are known and loved by a wonderful God who is always with us. May we each know how precious we are to you, and may such truth lift us beyond our wounds and our loneliness to find ourselves complete in you. We pray this morning too for our governments and our leaders. We pray that you would be at work in and through them, that you would expel any pride or false agenda and instead fill them with a relentless pursuit of justice and care for all. We ask that you grant them wisdom as they lead us all across the world, particularly as we continue to journey through this pandemic. May we have confidence to put our trust in their leadership. As we take steps to reopen, Lord, grant to us all wisdom and courage as we go from place to place. May we have a respect for one another and a concern for one another. May the increased sense of community continue among us as we truly live out a love for our neighbour. We pray too for small businesses, for those who have an uncertainty with employment. We ask, Lord, for your provision and your peace in uncertain times. And for us all, Lord, may your Spirit move in our hearts and minds as we worship together. Examine our attitudes and actions. Lay bare the things we need to confess and challenge us with your word, guiding us on to paths that lead to life. For we are your people, called by your name. So hear these prayers and intercessions, O wonderful God. Be quick to respond, we pray. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Our New Testament reading this morning is taken from Paul's letter to the Romans, Romans chapter 8, verses 24 and 25. Let's listen to God's word. For in this hope we were saved, but hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. And may God bless this reading of his holy word. Amen.
Over these past few weeks, we have journeyed alongside the lectionary readings for this season. A few weeks ago, the Reverend Ken shared with us from the gospel passage for that week from the book of Matthew. Last week, Reverend Louise shared with us from the epistle reading from Romans. So this week, I thought, why not stop with one of the Old Testament texts and see what it has to say to us in this day and in this season. The psalm for today is one that I'm sure is familiar and that you've heard before. Psalm 139. It was read for us not so long ago in the service. This psalm is both beautiful in its poetic design and its use of imagery that illustrates for us this intimate picture of how God knows the psalmist and how the psalmist knows God. But yet in this psalm, there's also a deeply profound theology about the nature and the presence of God and how we are to understand our relationship with him in light of this nature that it declares. The psalm, like so many others, is a precious gift to us that puts words to our experience and our encounter with God. As we read through the verses of this psalm, there are explicit theological concepts in it that declares the all-knowing and ever-present sovereign God. The God whose presence is inescapable, who knows us with an intimacy and a detail. It expresses an understanding of God as creator, one who has so fashioned each and every one of us in such a wonderful way. It attributes all things under the care of the creator, the one who knows his creation best. The psalm is strong in its doctrine of God that it voices, and it's clear that for the psalmist, God is almighty, God is great, and God is with him. Yet as we read this psalm, it feels not so much like a textbook description of who God is, but rather a very intimate expression of thanks and praise from one who knows that he is known by a loving, gracious, and present God. A key word in Psalm 139 is know, or known, or knowledge. This same word and sentiment is repeated 7 times within the verses, reinforcing the importance of the message of the psalmist, that he is completely, 100% known by God. And there's a depth to this message of being known, maybe even at times a discomfort. When we think of people in our lives that know us, how many of them can we say really know us? Know all the aspects of our life and our personality, know all the deepest and sometimes darkest thoughts of our minds, know every act or thought or deed that we have ever done or will do. If I think of my life, certainly I have people that I consider to be very close to me, but do they know me in the way that the psalmist declares that God knows him? For this psalmist, such knowledge evokes praise and thanksgiving. He is found whole in the fact that God knows him so intimately that there is nothing that he is holding back. It evokes praise because he is confident not only that he is deeply known, but that he is deeply loved. For this psalmist, there is no discomfort in God knowing all aspects of his life. Rather, there's an invitation that God, in knowing him, should test and try his thoughts and feelings and rid the psalmist of anything that would be found displeasing. He feels so fully known that such knowledge beckons him to be transformed even further. He's not retreating or hiding himself away, but instead embracing being seen. He is exposing his vulnerability, for he's certain that that is what is required when it comes to the relationship that he has with his creator. And it's on that that I want us to dwell for just a few moments this morning. And as we dwell on it, here's some questions I want you to hold in your mind. Firstly, do we know ourselves to be fully known by God? Does this evoke in us a sense of thankfulness, or does it unearth shame? Are we able to lay our vulnerabilities before God, echoing the words of the psalmist and asking God to search us and to know our heart and to test our thoughts? This psalm is not isolated in the claim of how God is all-knowing and ever-present. Such truth is echoed throughout scripture, and we are repeatedly told of a God who has created us and who is at work within us. Time and time again, we are reminded that God is always with us, that he is never far away, that he never slumbers nor sleeps. This picture that scripture as a whole paints for us is one of a God whose love for us is so great and so extravagant that he even offered his own son for our redemption. As we consider scripture, we should have no doubt in our mind of a God who knows us and loves us and who is most assuredly with us. Such a truth is not determined by how we feel at any given time. So whether we feel like God is with us, well, the truth is he is. or whether we feel like God knows us, well, the truth remains that he does. And so as we reflect on this psalm, we are invited to ask of ourselves, do we know this truth for ourselves? Can we acknowledge it? Can we find confidence and praise because of it? We are fully known by God. Sometimes we want to shrug this off, though, because actually we don't want to be fully known, because to be fully known is to be fully vulnerable. We know that we are sinners, that none of us are perfect, and so perhaps we have things in life or thoughts in our mind that we want to hold back from God, that we don't want him to see, because if he does, then we feel exposed. We don't want to unearth shame, or perhaps we don't want to change. So perhaps it's easier to say that God doesn't really know us, or God isn't near, because his closeness and his holiness and his burning love for us exposes us in a way that makes us feel fearful. We become aware of our sin and our shame. If we keep God at a distance, then we can pretend somehow like those things aren't present in our lives. Yet this psalm invites us to have a courage to ask God to search us and test us. It invites us to hold nothing back. Now, we can read over this word search quite quickly and miss the depth that it portrays. So it's not like this. I remember when I was younger and I was trying to find something, and I would go to my mum to ask where it was, and her reply would normally be, "Did you look?" To which, of course, I would reply, "Yes, of course I looked." And then my mum would get up and go into my room and find this missing object within 10 seconds, because the truth of it was that my version of looking wasn't really looking. I'd walk into the room and scan it, and unless the item jumped out and hit me up the face, well, then I simply couldn't find it. And I see my nieces do the same thing now, and I hear my sister echo the same question that mum would have said to us. The truth is that I never really looked at all. I didn't look below the surface. When the psalmist asks God to search him, it's a bold request. It's not a look across the surface like I used to do. So it's a little bit more like this. So when we see the police or the search and rescue as they take on a search for a missing person, or as they scour the area for evidence of a crime, it's a tireless, step-by-step and detailed search for the tiniest of clue or the smallest of sign. There's an intentional looking and scouring. This is what the psalmist invites God to do. He holds nothing back. Being fully known is to be fully vulnerable. And in this is then to know yourself fully loved. Now, vulnerability is one of those words that we don't really like. And it's one of those emotions that we don't particularly want to embrace. When we look up the meaning of vulnerability in the dictionary, this is what we read. That vulnerability is to be exposed to being attacked or harmed, either physically or emotionally. That it comes from the Latin word which means to wound. Now, there's nothing about that definition that makes vulnerability seem attractive or something that we want to embrace. Generally, we see vulnerability as something that we want to avoid. We see it as weakness. A few years back, as I was considering what vulnerability looked like, I came across a TED talk by Brené Brown, and she was talking about vulnerability. And one sentence from this talk has always stuck with me, and she said this: vulnerability is the core of shame and fear and our struggle for worthiness. But it appears it's also the birthplace of joy, of creativity, of belonging, and of love. Let me read that again. Vulnerability is the core of shame and fear and our struggle for worthiness. But it appears it is also the birthplace of joy, of creativity, of belonging, and of love. It's a really interesting talk, and I encourage you. You can go on YouTube and find it and have a listen. It's deeply thought-provoking. As she researched shame, she came across the discovery that for wholeness, or to feel wholehearted, that actually this could only really be accomplished by embracing vulnerability. For in exposing our vulnerability, we find freedom and we find life. It's like the psalmist already knew this so long ago and penned it all for us to see. To be fully known is to be fully seen, is to be fully vulnerable and exposed before God. For in all of that, then we can be truly known and truly loved. You see, if we don't invite God into all parts of our lives, the good, the bad, and the ugly, then we cannot know ourselves fully loved. We trip over the obstacle, if God only knew this about me, he wouldn't love me. We trip over these lies that breed shame within us. For the truth is that God loves you. God sees you. God knows you. And while scripture tells us that nothing in this world, no powers of heaven, no powers of hell can separate us from the love of God that was shown to us in Christ. Nothing. The psalmist knows that to be fully known by God is such a wonderful truth. He declares how precious are God's thoughts to him. In his thankfulness, he responds with vulnerability and with surrender, because being fully known and fully loved are not possible without it. As God searches our hearts, what is it that must be exposed before him? What is it that we must be ready to lay down? Is it our pride, our greed, our self-importance? Is it wrongdoing in our life, or selfishness, or fear? Whatever it may be, lay it down. Only then do we have the freedom and the joy to know ourselves fully known and fully loved. And so I return to the questions I asked earlier. Do we each know ourselves to be fully known by God? Does it evoke in us a sense of thankfulness, or on earth a sense of shame? Are we able to lay our vulnerability before God, echoing the words of the psalmist and asking God to search us, to know our heart, and to test our thoughts? As we each answer those questions for ourselves, we come to pray. And as we do, we take a moment to be quiet. And as our prayer, we want to echo the words of Psalm 139. So join me in stilling your heart as we come before God in prayer. Let us pray. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you. Search me, God. Know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. This I pray. Amen.
Investigate my life, O God. Find out everything about me. Cross-examine me and test me. Get a clear picture of what I'm about. See for yourself whether I've done anything wrong. Then guide me on the road to eternal life.
Lord, I come to worship.
And as we come to close the service, we again turn to some of those verses that Viv read us from Psalm 139. This time we close with verses 23 and 24, which we can also use as a prayer. Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me into the way everlasting. And let us pray. Heavenly Father, what joy it is to know that you know everything about us, and even the things we do wrong can never separate us from your unveiling love. As a community of faith, help us to live out this truth in our lives. And may we only do those things that are pleasing in your sight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now, the grace. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all this day and forevermore. Amen.
You have searched me and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. Lord, you made me, understand me. You see where I walk and where I lie. Before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it all. Ever with me, all around me. To think on it is too wonderful.